Warfare in the ancient world was a brutal affair, yet there exist powerful accounts of heroic battles where opposing civilizations used cutting-edge military technology to overpower enemy states. Did the ancients actually have siege-busting tanks and hand grenades? Did they use chemical weapons and engage in biological warfare? This is the story of the most famous siege in history, the Battle for Troy. Our common perception of the ancient world is of cultured civilizations whose people were steeped in philosophy, science, and the arts. Yet there is intriguing new evidence which reveals that they were also highly skilled in the art of war and developed advanced military armament and weaponry to become a feared fighting force. The armies of antiquity were incredibly advanced and would use sophisticated war machines. Battles that they fought were on a truly massive scale. The most legendary of these conflicts happened during the Trojan Wars. Warfare in the Bronze Age was sophisticated and lethal. Greek war engineers were using cutting-edge technology to develop an array of powerful weapons that could be produced on a mass scale. It would be the beginning of a fascinating period of arms development that would allow Greek armies to challenge other sophisticated and wealthy civilizations. There would be one violent conquest that would remain a mythical war, steeped in legend for thousands of years.
Troy is one of the greatest sieges in the history of warfare, simply because of Homer's wonderful epic poem, the Iliad.
Homer, the Greek poet, lived around 800 BC. He spoke about a series of heroic battles known as the Trojan Wars that had taken place centuries earlier. The tale of the Siege of Troy would become the greatest story ever told, one that would appeal across cultures and time. The Iliad provides a powerful account of warfare and weaponry from the ancient world, and a fascinating insight into how battles were fought by late Bronze Age warriors.
The story of the Iliad begins with the seduction of the most beautiful woman in the contemporary world, Helen of Sparta, wife of King Menelaus. She had fallen in love with Paris, one of the younger sons of Priam, king of Troy, and she had run away with him back to Troy.
The Trojans won't prevail on him to send her back to her husband. The outraged husband, Menelaus, contacts his brother, Agamemnon, the high king of Mycenae. Between them, they organize a massive flotilla to get back the errant wife.
The ancient Greeks lived in small city-states, Athens, Sparta, Corinth, and Thebes, each of a population of around 100,000, and each of which vied for military supremacy. Sometimes these city-states would put aside their differences and come together in leagues, forming one super force that would fight against a more powerful and common enemy. During the Bronze Age, one powerhouse of a state would emerge that would have ambitions to rule not only Greece, but also the whole of the Mediterranean. The state would be known as Mycenae, ruled by the powerful Agamemnon.
Agamemnon summoned other Greek leaders to go on a great expedition to punish the Trojans, to get Helen back, and to destroy the rich and powerful city of Troy.
The Battle of Troy would be fought by two superpowers, the Greeks, who were led by their commander-in-chief, Agamemnon, and the Trojans, ruled by King Priam.
In the Siege of Troy, the Greeks were really up against it. Troy was an extremely well-defended city, huge Cyclopean walls of massive masonry. The Greeks had no conventional way of burrowing through.
King Agamemnon would have to use all his warfare skills to fight the Trojans and break the walls of this mighty city. The Siege of Troy would last 10 years, and it would take an ingenious and audacious siege engine to break the city's defenses and bring about its destruction. But over 3,000 years after the event, historians have been forced to confront an intriguing mystery. Did this extraordinary war machine ever exist at all? Here at the British Museum in London, archaeologists have analyzed clues from the ancient desert kingdom of the Assyrians. discovered in the northwestern palace of Ashurnasirpal, this amazing bas-relief offers startling evidence that complex war machines were in use much earlier than was previously believed. Julian Reed is former Near East curator at the museum.
In front of me, we've got a siege engine, and the way that that works is that it's got a beam coming out. People inside the siege engine would have maneuvered that beam up and down and to and fro in an effort to break down the wall bit by bit.
Assyria in the 700s, Persia in the 500s, developed all the techniques for taking a fortified place, bar one, that were ever known in the ancient world.
Geniuses of siege warfare, the Assyrians commonly employed a device known as a wall fly whenever they laid siege to a city or fortified town. The palace bas-reliefs clearly illustrate them armed with wooden drills, reinforced with wall-penetrating iron heads.
The Assyrian war machine is a wheeled structure, a wickerwork shelter with a domed turret at the front, a bit like the neck of a horse.
The framework of an Assyrian siege engine was covered by a protective material such as canvas, felt, or hide. This protected flammable wooden towers and parapets from fire.
Something that they could do would be to throw down torches with burning tar on them to set the machine on fire. The Assyrians anticipated this by setting up a water vat inside the machine and arranging for water to be poured on the outside to keep it wet. There are two things looking rather like the ends of hose pipes coming out of the front of the siege engine, which would have been letting water down.
So, could these giant war machines have been the inspiration for the ancient poet's myth of the Trojan horse?
Because a siege engine is a device holding soldiers which attacks an enemy town, you could then from that derive a story about soldiers being hidden inside such a thing.
Startling evidence has recently been recovered from Syria, which suggests that these machines were already in use 600 years before the Trojan War. From this, it is clear that the ancient Assyrians were already extremely familiar with advanced siege-busting war machines during the time of Troy. We do know that power in the ancient world was determined in the theater of war, and victory on the battlefield was a gift only bestowed by the almighty gods. One of the most important Greek sanctuaries of antiquity would be Olympia, birthplace of the Olympic Games, and dedicated to the most powerful of the gods. Zeus was the arbiter of war and the god to whom the Greek warriors would pray for victory in battle. The peoples of antiquity would offer the god of the cult they belonged to exquisite gifts and sacrifices. These were known as votive offerings. Votive offerings were believed to buy the favors of the gods and ensure victory in battle. This collection of warriors' helmets recovered from the site of Olympia are believed to have been votive offerings made to Zeus. They provide intriguing clues as to the scale and importance of warfare in ancient Greece. This bronze breastplate, complete with spear holes, is engraved with scenes of Zeus and is testament to the highly skilled metallurgy techniques developed throughout the Bronze Age. Scientific study of weapons that have been found over the last two centuries have revealed that the ancient peoples had a complex understanding of working with the metals available to them.
This is an ancient Greek helmet dating to about 650 BC. It's remarkably lightweight. It weighs about 3.25 pounds. That's about the equivalent of a modern infantry helmet.
Dr. David Starley is an investigative science officer at the Leeds Royal Armouries Museum in the UK and is using X-ray technology to investigate the internal structure of this ancient helmet.
The great advantage of X-radiography is that it allows us to see beneath the surface, but it doesn't do any damage to the object itself.
The advanced metal thickness of this late Bronze Age helmet baffles us today.
The density of the X-ray image relates to the thickness of the metal. It's been produced to very high standards. It's a very even 2 millimeter thickness. We think of bronze as being an easily cast material, but in fact the evidence seems to be that this was hammered. We don't have any of the little imperfections, things like gas bubbles, casting defects in this object.
Only now are we beginning to understand just how advanced Bronze Age weapons were.
It doesn't get more advanced than this. It's a superb piece of not only technology, but craftsmanship.
The Greeks were renowned throughout the ancient world as highly skilled metallurgists, having mastered how to make bronze by mixing tin and copper. Military engineers were for the first time able to develop high-quality, durable, and effective weapons. In the Shefton Museum in the UK, some of the world's earliest examples of Greek Bronze Age weaponry date back to the middle of the 16th century BC.
Weapons in the late Bronze Age are not toys. They're absolutely lethal. They're sharp, they're strong, you can see they're durable.
Intriguing archaeological evidence is beginning to emerge that over 3,500 years ago, Greek technology was becoming sophisticated enough to allow production of weapons on a mass scale.
The weapons themselves show you that these people were experts.
This rapier-like sword is one of the world's oldest surviving examples of Bronze Age weaponry. Incredibly, it dates from 400 years before the Battle of Troy and is an early example of Greek military craftsmanship.
This is 3,500 years old, and I could sharpen it up and I could use it. We cannot produce this today. It can't be done.
We know that King Agamemnon had a vast arsenal of weapons and the huge war chest needed to finance an invasion. Yet today, one overpowering question remains. Did the Battle of Troy ever really happen? Many believe that the Trojan War is merely the stuff of myth and legend. But one man would shock the world with his amazing discoveries and forever change our understanding of warfare in the ancient world. Around 1200 BC, King Agamemnon raised a super force to bring back Helen, the beautiful queen of Sparta, from the clutches of the Trojans. Yet this was not just a simple rescue mission. Agamemnon had laid plans to control the entire Mediterranean. Queen Helen provided the perfect excuse to lay siege to Troy, one of the most powerful and wealthy regions of the late Bronze Age. He raised the greatest fleet ever assembled in the ancient world, and Helen was to go down in history as the face that launched 1,000 ships. Ancient historians now believe that in reality, the armada was to have been a fleet of 100 ships. But even by today's standards, this would still have constituted a massive army of up to 5,000 men. It was the biggest invading force ever to cross the Mediterranean. Most of the ships in the fleet were penteconters, the first purpose-built warship. A large penteconter could be up to 100 feet in length. Its width of over 13 feet would allow the rowers to work the oars. These ships would have a top speed of 9 to 10 knots, which is about 12 miles per hour, the equivalent of a ferry traveling through the Aegean today. King Agamemnon assembled a mighty force of 5,000 men, but then he was to face his greatest challenge. The walls appeared impenetrable, but until the 19th century, the details of the story were impenetrable too. Troy carried mythical significance, due mainly to the classical texts surrounding it. Homer's Iliad. In the Bodleian Library in Oxford is one of the oldest surviving copies of Homer's epic text.
The text that we have here, the so-called Hawara Iliad, dates from round about 200 AD. The bit in front of us tells of the mustering of the Greek ships that went to Troy.
For centuries, archaeologists searched in vain for the true location of Homer's Troy. Then, in the 19th century, a German historian set out to find it using the Iliad as a compass. What Heinrich Schliemann discovered was to shock the Western world.
Schliemann and his predecessors read the Iliad almost as a code. They were searching for clues for the real historical site of Troy.
Schliemann identified one particular mound in northwestern Asia Minor and set about investigating it, excavating it, and struck lucky.
Schliemann traveled to Turkey, to the area around Hisarlik. Here he thought that he would find Troy. Having negotiated with two Turkish businessmen who owned the land around a fort mound, Schliemann started digging. and began to uncover the remains of a great city. He knew he was onto something extraordinary. Troy was right beneath his feet.
We agree that he was right. He did find the site of Troy.
In 1874, Heinrich Schliemann discovered a large cache of gold and silver. It is the richest single find to date, discovered from the site of the excavations. He called it Priam's treasure, as he believed it to be the king of Troy's gold buried at the time of the Trojan Wars. Over 100 years later, some of the world's leading archaeologists are still trying to unravel the reality behind the myth of Troy.
In the late Bronze Age, we estimate that in the order of 5,000 to 10,000 people may have lived here.
Ernst Pernicka's team continued to piece together evidence that Troy was inhabited by a wealthy and warlike people. Remarkably, archaeologists uncovered new evidence that suggests that epic siege warfare taking place here isn't so far-fetched.
We have a few arrowheads, like this one here, indicating warfare. We do not know why we have so few, but maybe they have been collected again because bronze was still a very valuable material.
It is incredible to think that these finds may have been used in the siege of Troy. There are other tantalizing clues to suggest that this may have been the site of a major battle.
An interesting fact is these pebbles, river pebbles, they were collected and brought up on the hill. They are usually interpreted as slingshots. It is the more likely because we have similar pebbles made of burnt pottery, burnt clay.
The fact that a large number of slingshots has been found at the site leads experts to believe that a surprise attack may have left the occupants with no time to use them to repel the enemy.
Another interesting feature that may have to do with warfare are these polished stones. They have a hole in the middle. They can serve as an end piece on a chariot.
But from these fragments, can we discover what armor and weaponry they would have used in hand-to-hand combat? At the time of the Siege of Troy, heroic individual combat played an integral part in deciding the outcome of a conflict. King Agamemnon brought along an elite force of ultimate fighters that struck fear into all who faced them. They were led by one of the finest warriors in the ancient world, Achilles.
It happens to contain the passage describing Achilles and his myrmidons, and one can even see the name Achilles, Achilleus, in Greek.
The greatest battle of the Iliad tells of a showdown between Hector, the foremost Trojan champion, and Achilles, the Greeks' finest warrior. Their duel was to be the defining moment in 10 years of brutal conflict.
Ordinary soldiers moving in close with their short swords would have been a rough and dirty business. Whereas the duels that Homer describes in his poem, these are more idealized, perhaps almost ritual combat. When the Greek hero Achilles was eventually provoked into fighting with Hector, the Trojan champion, they met on the plain outside Troy. It was the custom to throw spears, first of all. Neither spear found its target. So Hector moved in with his sword to finish the thing. By this time, Achilles had retrieved his spear and thrust it through Hector's throat.
Warriors like Hector and Achilles would have been brought to the battlefield by the first great war machine of the ancient world, the chariot.
This was a culture that prided valor in man-to-man combat, looking at the whites of the eyes. The reality of fighting hand-to-hand is you not only had to be incredibly fit, you had to have incredible stamina. It's the same with a sword cut. If you're gonna take a man's arm off, then the amount of power in a stroke like that is exhausting.
The style of heroic fighting between two warriors like Hector and Achilles was similar to gladiator fighting at the height of the Roman Empire. This meant the chariot at the time of the Trojan War was used in a very specific way.
The chariots were used, therefore, as battlefield taxis, not just to drop the warrior off, but also to relieve him. There they are in front of their colleagues, winning fame and glory before one and all. But as they tire, their buddy comes in. He comes in, he jumps off, takes the man on they're going to take, and they make their getaway.
3,000 years ago, a revolution in weaponry saw lethal new armaments constructed on an industrial scale. This posed an epic challenge to King Agamemnon's military engineers. Could they develop the armor technology to avert mass casualties outside the walls of Troy? King Agamemnon's army had made an epic journey across the Aegean to the very gates of Troy. Faced with towering walls and near impregnable defenses, they began a siege that was to last a decade. But how did they survive 10 years in the open, brutally exposed to all that the Trojans could hurl down at them? Combining archaeological evidence with clues from Homer's text, modern weapons reconstructors are now piecing together the combat weapons and armor ancient Greek forces developed.
The most distinctive element of the equipment I'm carrying is probably the helmet. This particular one represents the final evolution of this style of helmet, which is a Corinthian. And it's very distinctive because of the very long cheek pieces at the front and closed face, which protects you when you're fighting against the enemy because you would have a big shield across your front.
Greek war engineers manufactured a style of helmet that maximized the wearer's critical senses of vision and hearing.
And during the Persian Wars, the ability to give command and control was very important. And with the earlier pattern helmets, that was closed off. So it's like wearing a seashell on your head. All you hear is the sea going round, so people point you at the enemy and give you a big push. Within the later periods, people had to hear what was going on.
In response to the developing arms race, Greek metallurgists needed to construct armor that withstood the deadly firepower that was now developing on the battlefields. One innovation used composite materials in an ingenious system to protect warriors in combat. Incredibly, the armor consisted of a high-intensity fiber material that Greek engineers designed to withstand metal-tipped arrows.
What we've got here is a linothorax, a linthorax, which is made up of layers of linen glued together. In fact, this one's got 14 layers of linen with a leather core in the middle. It's lighter than metal armor. It molds itself to your body when it's warm, but it is very, very hard and very, very protective. In many ways, it's akin to modern Kevlar body armor.
We used a composite bow at point-blank range to test the strength of linothorax technology.
That'll hurt. Well, I'm actually quite pleased with that because that was at point blank range. Remember, this is only cloth that's stopping this arrow. So at a normal combat range, I think that's about the best they could expect for. The fact it punched through, lucky shot.
Despite using a composite bow with a draw weight of 160 pounds, hitting at 90 miles per hour, only the tip of the arrow has penetrated. Greek war engineers would also use composite materials to build shields. In Athens Museum, a unique fresco survives of a figure of 8 shields that was used at the time of the Trojan Wars.
You can see how it covers all of my body. I'm well protected behind this with the disc shape, but the cutouts allow me to use the spear, which is the heroic weapon of the Homeric Age. This is the weapon that Achilles is using. Held in here, I've still got movement and can fight while I'm protected.
The reason the shield was so effective is because of the way it was constructed.
It's light, it's incredibly light, because it's made of wicker, willow, like a basket, tightly packed, tightly woven, very resilient, a little bit of flexibility to absorb impact, but very light and very mobile. With this shoulder strap here, slung on my body, it's no problem at all to fight with, and then a skin of leather just to reinforce that wicker, that willow, but we don't know how tough it's going to be against arrows.
For the first time in nearly 3 millennia, we put this marvel of ancient technology to the test. Even at point-blank range, the arrow has failed to penetrate the shield because of its ingenious construction. The beauty of its technology would also allow warriors to make running repairs. We now know that the ancient armies were equipped with armor that used cutting-edge fiber technology to defend itself against powerful infantry weapons. But there's more. Another recent discovery points to the ancients being well-versed with these advanced technologies. A stunning discovery in 1960 would confirm the true sophistication of ancient Greek warfare metallurgy in weaponry. This rare footage shows an extraordinary find near Mycenae in mainland Greece. Archaeologists uncovered this amazingly well-preserved type of armor that protected warriors over 3,000 years ago. This highly advanced piece of military armor was known as the Dendra Panoply. Even today, it rivals modern armament design.
Originally, it would have had a helmet, shoulder guards, bodyguard, thigh guards. It would have been incredibly difficult to use. Very heavy, hard to move around.
Consisting of 15 separate pieces of bronze sheets, the Dendra Panoply weighed about 35 pounds.
The armor used by Homeric heroes was probably quite effective. The Dendra Panoply indicates the power, the strength of this protective equipment.
The bronze sheets were designed to overlap one another for maximum protection and were clamped together by super strong fibers through holes as small as 2 millimeters. But how successful would it be against the deadly hail of firepower unleashed by the Trojans? One of the enduring mysteries of the Battle of Troy is how did the Greeks sustain a siege for so many years without the destruction of its army as they tried to penetrate the walls of the mighty city? In 1960, a remarkable archaeological find would cause us to rethink our perception of the sophistication of armor at the time of the Trojan War. Virtually no body armor from the time of the Siege of Troy has survived. However, excavations by Swedish archaeologists of a chambered tomb at Dendra in Greece would uncover an amazingly preserved full set of bronze armor that was contemporary with the warriors of the Greek forces besieging the Trojan walls. The main weapon used from any distance during the Trojan Wars was the bow and arrow. But would the Dendra Panoply be able to protect a warrior from an archer's bow? For the first time in over 3 millennia, we pit a champion archer against Mycenae armor, and we've filmed it in ultra slow motion.
Well, that was fantastic. This arrow tried to burrow its way through, and it's managed to penetrate half an inch, and it's dented and mangled the head of the arrow there. Would have shocked him, but it wouldn't have hurt the man at all.
Even using the armor-piercing bodkin, champion archer Mike Ashington failed to cause significant damage to the Panoply. Amazingly, although Mike's third shot also strikes the edge of the Panoply, it glances off, snapping off the arrowhead without leaving so much as a mark on the shiny bronze surface. Another superb shot finds its target right on the heart, but yet again, the arrow fails to do more than puncture the outer layer of the bronze armor plate.
There's no way this guy's been hurt. He's been shocked, he's been terrified, but he's not hurt. He's still living to fight another day.
But what would it have been like having to wear this kind of armor?
It would have been incredibly difficult to use. Very heavy, hard to move around. Most fighting happens in the summer when the temperatures are over 100. You couldn't actually have worn it, let alone fought in it for long, before suffering from heat exhaustion. The warriors who would use it would be chariot-borne. They wouldn't actually have to walk or run around much. It's a trade-off between mobility, usability, and its primary function, defense.
The original helmet was constructed from boar's tusks, confirming the Homeric tradition of warriors constructing their helmets from hunting trophies. Ours is made with bone sewn onto a leather cap using linen thread or sinew. It is both malleable and very protective. Despite using a leaf head arrow, which was able to cleave one of the bone plates in two, the armor flexed, absorbing the force. Even hit at point-blank range, the warrior would have survived the strike.
Yes! Of course, this is the vulnerable part of this sort of armor. He managed to find the gap. It's gone through, broken the edge of the plate, through the leather lining. That really is a bad day.
But powerful infantry weapons and armor would not be enough for King Agamemnon to penetrate the fortress of Troy. According to the Iliad, the Greek forces laid siege to Troy unsuccessfully for many years.
At the time the Trojan War is set, the Greeks were sadly lagging behind in siege technology.
The Trojans had so far stood up to all the besieging forces' attempts to enter the citadel. The walls were of a special construction which made it nearly impossible for conventional siege engines to break through. Ditches were built adjacent to the wall to make it difficult to make a successful approach by a siege engine. And the walls were built at an angle, thwarting attempts to break through. In addition, the Trojans were extremely successful at defending their beloved city.
Besieging these impregnable fortresses was a difficult job. Not only were the walls impregnable, but the defenders would be constantly throwing weapons, dropping stones.
And worse, unbelievably, we now know that the ancients had access to both chemical and biological weapons.
There are lots of stories of chemical and biological weapons surviving from the ancient world. Scorpion bombs, poisonous insects, clouds of smoke.
Archaeologists and scientists have recently discovered that scorpions were actually used in ancient warfare.
During the Roman siege of Hatra, which is a city in present-day Iraq, the defenders threw pottery jars full of stinging insects and scorpions onto the Roman attackers. There's also evidence of chemical warfare from the ancient world. Naphtha is an inflammable chemical substance, a bit like napalm. The defenders of Hatra were able to throw this naphtha, presumably in pottery vessels, perhaps like these ones, and destroy war machines and cause chaos amongst the ranks.
In 1988, in Hama, Syria, a remarkable discovery was made surrounding a set of pottery spheres. These intriguing objects were revealed to be hand grenades dating back 1,000 years. According to Homer, the Trojans would use deadly scorpion poison to defeat the Greek warrior Achilles.
In Homer, we've got the death of Achilles, shot in the heel by a poisoned arrow. The ancients had such biological techniques. They knew how to inflict pain and death in a variety of ways.
The siege of Troy had lasted 10 years. King Agamemnon and his troops had failed in their mission to break down the walls of Troy and bring back Helen. But there would be one final attempt to defeat the Trojans, and it involved a sophisticated siege machine never before seen on the battlefields of antiquity. For a decade, King Agamemnon had laid siege to the impenetrable citadel of Troy to try to destroy the wealthy and powerful Trojans. Each year, the Greek forces sailed back to Troy in a new attack to sack the city and reclaim Helen from the clutches of the Trojans.
Throughout the centuries, it's been quite common for warfare to be waged on a seasonal basis, for warfare to be waged in the summer, and people would go home in the autumn where they would be supervising the harvesting of the crops and seeing to the economy that funded their armies.
Each year, once the Greek forces left to return home, the Trojans would celebrate the enemy's departure. But in the 10th year, everything changed. For the invading Greeks would come up with a daring, clandestine operation. The man who devised the ingenious plan was Odysseus, a superior Greek commander and close ally of King Agamemnon. He would instruct his military engineers to create the most famous siege machine ever to be written about in history. The Greeks needed such a plan, as the fortifications and defensive strategies employed by the Trojans were at the cutting edge of siege technology. But is the Trojan horse just a myth? Archaeological discoveries at Troy suggest it was more real than we once thought.
recent years, the last 5 years or so, there's been some really good archaeology going on at Troy, and they've found a number of things. We always used to believe that Troy was just this citadel on top of this great rock precipice. Apart from anything else, how could you get a horse up there? But now we learn there's a lower town, a big lower town with mud brick walls. So that's something that they could get through. Around those walls, you've got this great double ditch going round the outside, and they found post holes, so it was palisaded, well defended. Now it starts to make sense. Now they've only got to get through the outer defences.
Archaeology at the site has revealed that the specific wall construction of Troy ensured that even the most robust siege machine would not be able to penetrate the walls of the city.
From this vantage point, you get a fairly clear sense of how impregnable the city of Troy would have been at the time of the wars in the late Bronze Age. Behind me, of course, is the northern side of the citadel of Troy, and on top of it, you have to imagine limestone and mud brick fortifications that would have risen about 30 feet high and would have had walls over 10 feet in thickness. No matter how sophisticated the siege engines were, they would have been unsuccessful in conquering the city from this particular side of the mound.
Trojans would have recognized that the lower town was more difficult to defend. Recent archaeological evidence suggests that they surrounded Troy with a system of ditches that would have prevented infantry, chariots, and siege engines from attacking the walls.
The ditch that you see here is 4 meters wide and up to 2 meters deep. The ditch is a very effective defensive system in a time when you have infantry and chariots. We have excavated here because we have an interruption of the ditch. So this is the main gate, the main entrance to Troy. If there was a Trojan horse, it must have come up here because this was the only entrance to the upper city, to the citadel.
The Greeks' plan centered on the fortification's one weakness, the gate. Odysseus understood that his siege engine needed to avoid the defensive mechanisms employed by the Trojans. So, did the Greek engineers at the time of Troy possess the skills to avoid a sophisticated device? And what intriguing evidence exists from the ancient world that supports the use of a siege engine? In 1961, a stunning ancient artifact would be found on the island of Mykonos, Greece. It would be one of the most significant objects in ancient history. It would become known as the Mykonos Vase. It is the oldest object in the world, which clearly depicts the myth of the Trojan horse.
One of the most significant depictions of the Trojan horse, mainly because it's so early, it's roughly contemporary with when Homer would have been composing his poems, is the Mykonos Vase.
The image clearly shows soldiers inside the massive structure. The shape of the colossal horse has led to fascinating theories about how the Trojan horse was constructed.
Naturalistic representations of horses in art don't occur until the 5th century BC. We have plenty of evidence for how they did depict horses. And they looked like this. It's primitive, it's pagan, it has this elongated fuselage of a body. It has this high camel neck. It's got a purple mane and tail. That was the high status prestige color of the ancient world that came from a sea snail just off that Turkish coast. You could perhaps put amethyst for eyes, bronze hooves. Now you've got the most splendid art object, and you can see why it seduced the Trojans into taking it inside.
And most importantly, the siege engine had to be so well designed that the ruse would never be discovered. Odysseus's plan was to create a siege engine that could house a specialist elite force of crack commandos who could open up the massive Trojan gates as long as they could get the siege engine inside the city. But the Greeks had a problem. Where would they get the timber to build such a huge structure? It is believed that the Greeks would use the materials from their Pentaconter warships to construct the siege engine. It was an ingenious but audacious strategy. But how would the Trojans be tricked? Fascinating new evidence is emerging that indicates two very significant elements in the story of the siege machine. The first is that Troy was a center for horse trading, and the symbol of the horse was very important in Trojan culture. Archaeologists are beginning to discover caches of horse bones that confirm Troy as an important location for horses in the ancient world.
These are horse bones. They were found in a late Bronze Age fill. It's evidence of horses being used here.
The second is that the horse was also a prized symbol in the ancient world, one associated with power and wealth. The shape of the siege engine thus would appeal to a strong tradition in the region. Finally, the horse was finished after 3 days by the Greek engineers. It was a magnificent and imposing structure, one that would have attracted the awe of the Trojans as it sat on the shores of Troy. But why would the Trojans bring the siege engine into the city?
In order to understand how this ruse might have expected to work, we need to understand the religious mindset of the peoples of that region and that time.
The Greeks had vanished from the plains of Troy, leaving the horse outside the gates of the city. The Trojans believed that King Agamemnon had surrendered and fled back across the Aegean. He left the Trojan horse as a gift to the gods to ensure a safe journey across the dangerous seas. But the Trojans had other ideas. If they took this beautiful effigy inside their city, they could offer it to their own gods, bringing the magic of the offering onto their side.
A useful way of winning a battle was to attract the opposition gods over to your side. And the best way of doing that was to bring it inside the fortifications, to bring it through the walls, and to set it up in the midst of their city, so that this offering from the Greeks, in fact, became an offering to the gods of Troy.
It had taken King Agamemnon and his warriors 10 years to take the upper hand in the siege of Troy. They had managed to create an elaborate foil with their elite forces penetrating the mighty city walls. One cannot imagine what it must have been like for the crack team of commandos led by Odysseus inside the Trojan horse. Even though they were the most highly skilled fighters of the ancient world, they had to endure 100-degree temperatures for probably up to 24 hours as they waited for Odysseus's plan to work. Meanwhile, King Agamemnon and the rest of his forces covertly returned to the shores of Troy in the darkness of the night, ready to sack the city once the gates of Troy had been opened by Odysseus's men. Once inside, the Greeks would show no mercy.
The besiegers would have swept through the town, killing indiscriminately, not only the warriors, but women, children, even animals.
In the end, there were few Trojan survivors. King Agamemnon's vicious assault and burning of the citadel revealed the ruthlessness of the siege warfare in antiquity. It was one of the bloodiest and most barbaric sackings known from the ancient world. Even today, the meaning of the Trojan horse carries huge significance in modern culture, being associated with deception and fraud. The siege of Troy would have cost vast amounts of money, but as with all wars, ancient or modern, the biggest investment would be in the quest for supreme military technology.
In the ancient world, as ever, warfare was the single greatest incentive to technological progress.
We may never know whether the legend of the Trojan horse is myth or reality, but we have seen evidence from the ancient world that suggests warfare in the late Bronze Age used advanced cutting-edge technology, much of which we no longer have the knowledge or skills to recreate. The Siege of Troy was long considered to be little more than a fanciful myth, but today, new discoveries are making us reopen the history books and rethink everything we thought we knew about the ancient world. What other finds remain hidden from us, yet to be discovered?